I'm sorry.
If you would like to get your song reviewed, dear listener, there's the Filthy Capitalist option. It's where he says, you straight to the head of the line. You don't have to be a part of the lines. You don't have to be part of the group.
Wait a minute.
And the biggest thing. Up right in front of everybody. 125 gets you there. You do that 3 times and then get mashed down to the $75 rate for perpetuity.
Yes!
Also, there is a band review option. So if you've got a band and you're trying to get your band some exposure, hit me up at itsori@gmail.com and I'll show you the details about how to pull
you
that off.
You can also jump on Patreon and there is a option on the tiers to be able to get your band reviewed. Yep. Obviously, we can't lie to you, so we can't guarantee a positive review. Get what you get.
It's just rubbish.
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 That's British for garbage.
My favorite is the community option. $1 at the gate gets you in a Patreon. You get to join an alliance. The alliance joins their points together, and that helps determine what songs that we do.
The alliances hang out on Discord.
Shh, message me on Patreon to get the link.
And they do all kinds of other cool things. They do Minecraft. Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah, yeah. It's really a community within the community. Anybody can go on the village, facebook.com/vinandsori. There's 160,000+ people on the channel. What's cool about the Discord is that it offers a real opportunity for community, connection, friendship, that type of thing.
But, and it's on Discord, so if you're not a Facebook person, it's for you.
You start off at $1.
Right.
Plus you get exclusives. Sori and I are working on a song. So the first 15 seconds of that was on Patreon. Also, at $15 tier and above, when we actually debut the video, they're going to be there live with us. There you are, dear listener.
Buy our merch.
Buy our merch indeed. Merch. The challenge shall lead them.
Yes.
Okay, y'all, we got a mega stream coming up on the way. This is the Agents of Ambitus or Ambitus. I am not sure how to do that. This is the stream, is the agent's favorites from this year. So as you can see there,
oh,
boom.
And that's why they have that logo, the 2021 thing.
Correcto, cool. correcto. The first song, well, the first band we're listening to is a band called Death Heaven, which is an interesting name for a band considering we're music and that's where you hear it, is the ear gate. But Death Heaven is the name of the band. The name of this song is a pretty interesting song. It's a giant
mass of color.
Yes, great.
But this was for the
mass
big homie
of
negative
color.
Vibes.
Yes, so
negative
it's,
vibes fix this one. So let's see what negative
it's
vibes.
It's his first. Okay, having said that, dear listener, here we go. Death Heaven.
Oh, wait a minute. Hold on. Introduction. The Agents of
Ambitus, I don't know.
Present 2021 in review. Our goal was to introduce you to some of the highlights of the year for 2021 from bands you may have never even heard from before.
Before?
We endeavor to pick bands that never have been reviewed by Vin and Sori. This is not necessarily a best of list of songs released in 2021, but this is some of the music we loved this year and we wanted to share it with the village.
See there? Aww. That's the 2021.
Yeah, cool.
That's the Angels of Ambitus. Ambitus. Okay, but is it Bitus or Bitus? I think it's Bitus. Okay, having said that, dear listener, we have the songs, we have the lyrics. The time has arrived. Let's go. Go. Great mass of color. Let's go. I could see why that was Song of the Year for yeah. someone. Holy smokes.
Negative Vibes. Wow, that was a good one.
That was his Song of the Year?
Well, no, they didn't say Song of the Year. Remember, it's just what they enjoyed this year a lot.
Oh.
But but they picked them not because they were the best of the year, because they were trying to pick bands we'd never heard of before.
Okay.
And wow, that was... That goes
I
in...
I love
there's
that
a
style.
Certain, yes. I was going to say, there's a certain bucket of songs that you have that is like this, and it goes in that bucket,
yeah.
right?
You talking about me specifically?
You specifically, yeah.
You're right. You're completely right.
You get in this certain moods, and you play certain music with your moods.
Yep.
And this is...
This is definitely
this
one
is
of them
one
for
of those.
Sure.
Yeah, for you, yeah. for sure.
It usually works out for you when I'm in a mood to listen to shit like this, though.
You know what I'm saying? I do.
So... it's definitely up there of one of his favorites of the year.
Quiet as a cradle, I laid in a middle night drift, spinning, hissing at the moon, conjured up the flowers to fix my impression of the gloom. I liked that because it sounded like, you know, maybe everything seemed so dark. And like, life is so much about choices. And we can choose to be very miserable or we can choose to be happy. And circumstances are what they are. And, you know, like, I was really trying to have a good day today. And it's like, you know, I told you, I got up early. I, you know, the shower wasn't working because they were changing the hot water tank. And so that kind of set me off because I'm like, you know. Then, anyway, I was downstairs. I was cooking my breakfast. And I literally dropped an entire, I don't know how it happened, dropped an entire egg on my sock foot. So then it seeped into
your
the sock.
Foot?
Yeah, it wasn't like just a barefoot.
One foot had a sock, one didn't?
No, it was that my foot had a sock on it, and when I dropped the egg on it, the egg seeped into my sock.
Oh, I see.
And, you know, I think like everybody else, we hate wet socks, but like the idea of salmonella sinking into my sock and I couldn't take a shower was not good for me. But I was like, okay, I started getting a little frustrated. I'm like, no, I'm just going to let that one go. And then like right after that, I reached for the butter and like it like fell on me. It fell all over my shirt. I was like...
What?
I was getting,
you were like, what?
I was just trying. I was determined to have a good day. I was determined not to be miserable, even though I felt like I didn't sleep enough and there was other things, whatever. But so that's to me what he's doing when he said, because he said, I laid in the middle of the night spinning, hissed at the moon. So I took that as like he had like sort of like this negative sort of feeling. I don't know if that's what he meant, but that's what I took it as. And then conjured up the flowers to fix my impression of the gloom. So like when I was a kid, and I had to do a bunch of dishes, I would take the soap bottle and I would go and make tiny little bubbles come out. And then that was like kind of helped my mood brighten because I was doing the dishes. So I was like trying to find different things like that, you
so
know, to
do that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I just, the vibe was just crazy, man.
Oh,
like
so
it was
good.
So chill.
It was smooth.
It was chill.
Yeah.
It was smooth. You know, it just felt really, really good. Everything like took its time. Nothing was really being forced.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It was just like a very, very chill situation. And the lyrics added to the chill for me.
Oh,
like
for
just,
sure.
Just the way that, and the way that the singer was like singing the song along with the lyrics. It was just a thing of beauty, man. They like really figured that shit out. The video was interesting because it's Great Master Color. And they're you know, he talked about red a lot. Things were fading into red.
Yeah, yeah.
And the video background was blue.
What does that mean?
So that's kind of weird. But, But yeah,
fading into red. I was confused.
What do you
because,
mean?
Because, excuse me, dissolving into red. Literally, the only thing that I could think of was like, you're gonna say train always goes to that station, but passion or like sex. But that was not what was happening in the song. It seemed like it was fading into like chill.
He says, "Quiet as a cradle, I laid in a middle night drift, spinning, hissed at the moon, conjured up the flowers to fix my impression of the gloom."
It kind of sounds like you know, wake in the middle of the night, you know?
Yeah, for sure, for sure. I feel them all, great mass of color, flooded in my bed. I feel them all, big mass of color, flooded in my bed.
Those
dissolving
are the
into red.
Those are the flowers?
Yeah, maybe. Maybe, and then the red would be all the roses. Half awake, holding my ghost in the morning. Sunlight coming down the bend, maroon sky on the send. My great former terror when trees gave doves the leaves. That's a good line, bro. When trees gave doves the leaves.
My great former terror? When trees gave doves the leaves?
And I was grim, drunk death, a stranger to myself.
What does that even mean?
What do you mean?
My great former terror when trees gave doves the leaves? The only thing that I can think of is literally, you know, remember when Noah sent the dove out and it went and it brought back leaves from the trees and said that they could leave the boat?
Yeah.
So do you think that there's any reference to that where he's saying it's time to, maybe it was time for him to leave that state? I don't know.
No.
So just a guess. So no, what do you think he means?
I just like the idea of the trees giving the doves their leaves. I wasn't even thinking about
he how says that my great fit. Former terror.
I was just saying, I wasn't even thinking about how it fit into that. I just like the concept of the trees giving the doves their leaves.
Oh.
Instead of just saying that the dove incidentally eats the leaves or the dove incidentally lands on the tree. Oh,
but that the tree gave it.
It's that the tree gave... yeah, I'm listening to this thing about you know, all these physicists. And it's not just physicists. It's a whole bunch of disciplines. These people are abandoning the concept of a physical universe, which is very fascinating to me. And then... It's talking about now you've got these gigantically brilliant Western scientists now giving credence to a real scientific form of animism, where even atoms themselves are conscious to some degree and have will and sentience. So, like, you know, at first it was just physicists because, you know, the weird little experiment with a thing and you got to observe it and all that.
Yeah,
but even beyond that, like listening to Kurt John Mungle, he's got all these brilliant people on and they're all attacking physicalism from all these different vantage points.
Wow.
And it's crazy because they come from one guy's an engineer, another guy's and they're all basically saying that it's not going to survive into the next century of scientific, you know, enlightenment or whatever.
Wow.
So it's just fascinating when you hear about that because there was one guy that went so far as to say, he's like, I'm not sure. Well, there was one guy that was talking about the dichotomy between natural and supernatural not being a thing. I think you were there. And I was like, oh, I've been saying that on the channel for like a year. Yeah. But I'm coming from it from a theological standpoint. They're coming from it from the opposite end of a scientific standpoint. Mm-hmm. But it's just fascinating. And then the idea that all of these, you can have billions and trillions of electrons and neutrons, and they're sentient. And the only reason that we're seeing something that way is because they've decided to organize themselves in such a way, and that your whatever in your eye has basically made a deal and say, okay, we'll do that, and we can say that that looks like that, and that way he can function in this. It's just really weird. It's very weird stuff, and it's really interesting because when you look at these people, like, it's not like triumphalism, like, ha, we've discovered this thing. And they're kind of like, what the hell?
Yeah, yeah.
What do we do? What are we supposed to do with this? It's kind of weird. So anyway, when it talks about the trees giving the doves their leaves, that's what popped into my head. I was like, wow. Like, that's like the cooperative nature of, not nature, but the cooperative nature of reality itself. It's basically like so many things have to go together to accomplish what we call reality in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they have to agree to work together.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's just crazy to me. And, you know, you say, oh, it randomly happens. That's fine. You know, okay, look, you say, I mean, the majority report is that atoms are not sentient. Atoms don't know anything.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how we could possibly know that atoms don't know anything. Like,
there's a lot of things that how could like, you, how know, could you that? Know that?
We don't even know the nature of what consciousness is. Right. But anyway, like, so I'm looking at this, and he's talking about, you know, sunlight coming down the bend, maroon sky on the mend, my great former terror when trees gave doves the leaves, and I was grim, drunk death, a stranger to myself. I feel them all, great mass of color flooded in my bed. I feel them all, great mass of color flooded in my bed, dissolving into red. Do I need this affection? Do you? Do you need this confusion? Do you?
Is that the flowers talking back to him?
I don't know. I think he's talking about his girl here to some degree, right? Because he says he woke up beside his ghost or something like that. Remember that line?
Yeah, but I just thought that was like, I thought that he was having like in-body, out-of-body experiences, half awake holding my ghost in the morning. And you know, the experience that he's having with the flowers, and like, I just thought it was just, and he says he said something in here about,
said what?
I can't remember.
Just make it up. Go ahead.
No,
just...
I can't remember even. As soon as I was saying it, I got thinking. I was like picturing someone in a bed with flowers and all of that stuff. And then, like, remember that we watched that? It was really a very scary movie to me. It was a little too graphic for me, but there was that Midsummer's Eve or something like that. Midsummer something or other.
Midsummer Night's Eve.
That
Shakespeare thing?
Well, no. This was a movie. We went to the theater and it was like very gory. People like joined this cult thing and...
Oh, Midsummer.
Yeah.
That was the name. It was Midsummer. Yeah. Yeah.
And remember like everything was like when they took the stuff like that, all of a sudden the leaves were like talking to them or something. You know, like everything was like getting animated. Like
they
took that.
They ingested that thingamajiggy. Yeah,
That's what I was picturing. Oh no. He said something... Right here. Can I accept I'm real? And that to me was...
Heartwarming film.
Oh my God.
It was a very heartwarming film. For sure, for sure.
I felt like a traumatized child when I was watching it, to be honest with you. It was way too gory for me. I don't like gore. So it was just... It was one... There was like a couple of them like throughout your life that you're like, I should have never seen that. That was one of them I should have never seen. For so many reasons.
Tracy goes, this isn't like any physics I've learned. This must be bullshit. Or maybe the physics you learned is outdated.
Right. It's time to modernize. So the can I accept I'm real? To me, that was like, you know, the moment that you have multiple times throughout your life, or I guess everybody does, where you contend with your own consciousness, and it's like a weird experience.
It's an extremely weird experience.
Yeah, and so then he says, can I accept I'm real? Like, and I thought that he, to me, it wasn't about him and another person. Surprise, surprise. I was just picturing him, the experiences that he was having, and then he had, so you were talking about that science stuff that you've been studying, and like, this is kind of off subject, but you were listening to that thing on Parkinson's, and it was saying that, like, that there's certain... probiotics or prebiotics and stuff that
was postbiotics.
Postbiotics.
Yeah.
That I don't know if it can prevent it or eases the suffering or whatever. But I thought to myself, holy shit, wouldn't it be crazy if God set up the universe so that we could find the cures to everything and that we could have found the cures to it had we not have been killing so many children. If abortion wasn't so rampant, like here's this random person that finds that information.
Yeah.
How many random people with information that could have helped solve all of these things?
Yeah, that guy won a Nobel Prize a couple of years ago for the postbiotic thing.
I just had never had, I never thought to myself, hey, is it possible that every single thing that we suffer from is treatable? We were just talking about that AIDS thing. You know, in the 80s, it just wiped whole.
It's a death sentence.
Yeah. And now people are living with it.
Yeah, I mean it's not a walk in the park, but yeah, I mean,
but it's not like it was.
And if COVID would have hit 100 years ago, it would have killed.
Oh my gosh!
Probably 20, 30 times more than the amount of people that it's killed now.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So yeah, no, yeah. I mean, can I accept that I'm real? Is
that what you got from it?
Yeah. Well, yeah. That question is such a fascinating question.
Yeah.
Because, you know, Jung was the first time. There's like a little 5-minute clip on YouTube. I wish I could find it. This is like this 5-minute clip on YouTube where Jung talks about, I guess he was walking home from school or walking to school, and it hit him that he existed and that he was real, and it terrified him. And I remember where I was when that whole thing happened, and I was, I don't want to say equally as terrified because I'm not in his, I didn't have his conscious experience because I'm not yet a panpsychist, who knows. But like, It's a very terrifying thing, man.
It always makes me feel like here. I'm falling backwards into a hole.
Yeah.
Of something so ginormous, I can't even process or comprehend it.
Yeah. But I've never heard it described that way. Like the way you said it, where you said you were contending with your own consciousness, and I think that's a brilliant way to put it. Contending with your own consciousness. I was listening to a guy debating Bernardo Kastrup yesterday. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Kastrup is a pure idealist. Mm-hmm. So I think I'm probably a combination of some idealism and physicalism. You know, I do think that there's got to, not necessarily, well, probably because Christianity makes such an emphasis on the physical bodily resurrection. Mm-hmm. And so
then you say matter does exist.
From that point, I'm not going to go all the way and say matter doesn't exist at all, which I'm pretty sure Kastrup does. But... So like we were, you know, you have combinations of idealism and physicalism, and then you have, you know, the modern age, which is pure physicalism, mm-hmm. and then you've got Kashyap, who's a idealist, mm-hmm. which doesn't believe any of this shit is any physical matter at all is real at all.
Wow.
So the guy says, I'm conscious, but I'm not conscious of my consciousness because I use my consciousness to gauge everything. So you can't, because of that, you cannot step outside of your own consciousness.
So
I didn't listen to what Kashyap said because I had pulled into the parking lot, so I stopped it.
Oh.
But I'll finish afterwards when I'm done with the day. But, like, yeah, that's a very, 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 very interesting way to put it.
Yeah.
Which is, I'm conscious, but I'm not conscious of my consciousness. So, anyway, when he says, can I accept that I'm real, that's a... Mm-hmm. That jumped out to me, probably mm-hmm. for the same reason it jumped out to you, because I think consciousness has been the theme of the year, right? Like, there probably hasn't been a week that has gone by where we haven't had some discussion about consciousness and all
yeah.
the rest of it.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
But I just really enjoyed...
And I think that when you have... We have six kids. So, like, all the individual consciousnesses is so interesting. And they're all so unique. They all have different ways that, like, can get under your skin, but they all have different ways that'll make you be like, oh my God.
Like, they're unbelievable.
This is unbelievable. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's the fact that we just take consciousness for granted, and many of us don't even think through, you know, it's really amazing. It's amazing to really sit and be conscious. And, you know, meditating, you know, it's... I've been doing a little bit of meditating at night, and it's extremely difficult. But if you can get...
Oh, really?
If you can get into that zone, it's a pretty cool experience.
I don't think I've ever gotten in that zone other than in prayer or in worship. It's True. Super easy for me to slip in there like that. No problem.
True. True.
But not... What are you trying to do? I don't understand.
I'm trying to... clear my mind, and I'm not even certain that you can completely have an empty mind, right? Because most of the time when somebody says empty your mind, you're thinking of a black sort of just nothingness, which black is a color,
mm-hmm.
or a frequency, yeah, whatever you want to call it. Black is a thing.
I picture an open space, but I get
even
it, yeah.
an open space. I mean, that's so I'm not certain that you can make your mind not think of anything. I'm not even certain that's true. But for me, it's
they told us it was so bad to do that at our college.
Well, never the Bible never tells you to empty your mind.
Empty your mind.
The Bible never tells you to empty your mind. It tells you to renew your mind. It tells you to meditate on the law of the Lord, that mm-hmm. type of thing.
That if you meditate on the scriptures, that's a way of emptying your mind. And it's emptying it of all the stressors and the
right.
thing. And just being able to just rest in the... Because I think that emptying your mind, the idea is to find a sort of peace. Because you've removed everything. And I think that for the Christian mind anyway, I think that it would apply to everybody, but especially to somebody who's conscious of God, mm-hmm. then you would say an existence with nothing, that is actually not peace. The most peace that I can find is a consciousness where I am conscious of God. And so then I think you would find that sort of calm peace that's there without, you know, thinking of it just an empty room. You know what I mean? Like meditate
yeah.
on the Lord.
No, I agree. I agree with that. I think there's a lot of utility in that. But it says, you know, and the Bible does tell you to guard your heart, for in it are the wellsprings of life.
Yep.
So for me, when I'm meditating, I'm asking myself some very, very specific questions. And they kind of get me to having that outer body type, you know, experience.
Mm-hmm.
That, because I remember like one of the clearest, the most memorable time I've ever had it was... I was hiding from something, like literally physically hiding from something. And it was a pretty terrible situation, pretty terrible family situation. So I was like trying to detach myself from the situation.
Mm-hmm.
So I was looking like mega inward, and then it was like, like, phew, like out, completely out of body experience. Very, very strange.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Yeah. So anyway.
Wow.
The scripture says to guard your heart with diligence.
That's so weird, because you would think that it would be the thinking about outside of your body. that would make you have an out-of-body, but you were so folded in that it made you out-of-body?
Yeah, I was really kind of like looking inward, like at myself, you know, type of thing, and wow, purposely excluding everything else. And then it was just like, I was in like a bush. I was like hiding in a bush, and it was just like, phew, very, very strange situation.
Oh my God.
And, you know, I didn't tell anybody that for years. And then I ran into you, and we talked about that, had a similar kind of experience. I was like, oh my God. Like, I thought I was the only one. And I was like, wow, there's two of us.
Yeah.
then I read Jung, and I'm like, there's lots of people that can do it, apparently. But yeah, anyway, I love the song. Wow. Really, really strong start for the song. What'd you give it?
To be honest with you, I almost think it's a 10 for me, because it was a... If it's not a 10, it was like a 9.8. So I think... Okay, 9.9. That's so disappointing for negative vibes. Negative vibes, like, yes,
would you
no,
give
yes.
it? Would you
well, it was like a 10. And then like, or maybe a 9.8. Okay, 9.9. But if you're like, you know, you're like a 100 person, all right, I have to go with a 9.9. So sorry.
I don't think you have to convince me to practice Lectio Divina. I don't think. I think I probably already do that. But yeah, send me some literature there, Perk. I really, really like this song a lot. This is a really good song. Hopefully all the other songs are good like this. No pressure, guys. This one's a strong one. Starting to get a 9.9 from me as well.
Wow,
9.9
okay.
from me as well. There I thoroughly it. Enjoyed it. And I'm going to listen. I'm pretty certain when I'm meditating tonight, I'm going to try to like put this on to some degree.
Absolutely.
Because one of the things I'm trying to like, so yeah, like I said, I asked myself a series of questions. Don't ask me what they are. Well, one of the questions I'm going to ask myself is, like, why does this song hit me the way that it does?
Mm-hmm.
You find so many like, breakthrough revelations if you just ask yourself some questions and really dwell on the answers. Like, really, really dwell on them. But you're by yourself, so there's nobody to, I don't know, impress or not make a bad impression on. You know, I don't know if that makes any sense. Mm-hmm. But anyway, there you are, dear listener. Vin out.
Sorry, out.
Gone.